Welcome to the Webster World Report, a program linking Webster University's global system while the world is in crisis. Here's our host, Rick Rockwell.
This is the November 6th edition of the Webster World Report. This time, a deep dive into education, flipped classrooms, gamification for classes, and student engagement, both online and in person. We'll hear from the experts as the educational system deals with the challenges of the coronavirus pandemic. But first, let's hear from newscaster Tierra Gray.
Students and faculty at Webster University listened to an expert panel about what likely will happen after this year's national elections. The session was held about a week before Election Day. The panel featured Professor Gwyneth Williams from Webster, who spoke about the political makeup of Congress.
When we look at the House and the Senate, and even look at the House, which is clearly favored to stay Democratic, but as we know, not all Democrats are the same or have the same constituencies.
The panel also featured Jamila Michener of Cornell University.
I think that the largest kind of wild cards are orient around what happens with the remainder of the time that we're navigating the pandemic, and what happens as far as building economically in the aftermath of the pandemic.
Students and faculty listened to the session via Zoom. The university's video series on race and equity issues called Webster Speaks featured members of Webster's Board of Trustees and artists during October. Board member Jovita Foster spoke of experiencing racism during her legal career during one program.
The issues of racism actually are real and happen to everyone. And I think that having had those experiences in my career early on has helped me understand that it's real, it happens, and to pick the times when I use my influence.
Foster is also the vice president and general counsel for Drury Hotels. The program on art and activism turned to the discussion of hip-hop. Multimedia artist Dale Chambers gave her views on this influence.
Hip-hop is a culture within itself. It's a subculture of a larger culture in this dominant culture we call America. So, yeah, everything about us is going to be commodified because that's what this engine does. And the most divisive thing that could happen is for us to stop listening to young people.
The entire Webster Speaks series can be found on the university's YouTube channel. The next program will be on Wednesday, November 11th, and is called My Journey Toward Becoming an Anti-Racist. Registration information for this series can be found on the university's website. Webster's campus in Vienna, Austria, moved back to offering all classes remotely this week due to the surging number of coronavirus cases in Europe. Webster's campuses in the U.S. and Thailand continue to offer some in-person and hybrid classes. All other campuses have converted to strictly online education at this time. Overall, the Webster system worldwide has reported about 107 cases of COVID-19 among students, staff, and faculty since the beginning of the pandemic. Webster's School of Communications hosted a two-day virtual conference in October on how communicators are collaborating with healthcare professionals to fight the pandemic. Dean Eric Rothenbuehler hosted the conference and spoke about one aspect of changing communications structures in his opening speech.
How many of us have had a doctor's appointment by telemedicine in the last 6-8 months? That's probably not going away, and that's a communication technology and a communication practice.
Speakers at the conference included representatives of SSM Health, the Missouri Foundation for Health, and the Centers for Disease Control, the CDC. The Dean of College of Arts and Sciences announced his retirement. Anton Tony S. Wallner made his announcement at the end of October, saying he would stay on through the end of 2020. Wallner is credited with securing numerous grants for the university, restructuring the College of Arts and Sciences, and securing more partnerships and accreditations. Wallner has led the College of Arts and Sciences for the past 2.5 years. Professor Michael Holsizer, who teaches psychology, will step in as interim dean in 2021. For the Webster World Report, I'm Tierra Gray.
Thanks, Tierra. Our first guest this week is Julie Smith, who teaches in the School of Communications at the Webster Groves campus. She's an expert on media literacy, and her first book was Master the Media. But she has a new book coming out this fall, and that was the topic of our discussion. The book is called Wake Them Up, Supercharge Your Classroom Engagement. She joined us via Zoom from St. Louis County, Missouri.
Well, the new book came from a woman who heard me present at a conference in Atlanta, and the session was all about stopping the boring lecture in the higher ed classroom. And she came up to me afterwards and said, do you want to write a book about this? And I said, sure. So I started doing research about why engagement is so important in the college classroom and why the old format of the sage on the stage just talking to students doesn't really stick with students anymore. And as I learned more about memory and how the brain works, it got me realizing how important it is to have a really active, loud, vibrant classroom, not just for engagement's sake, but it helps with student learning. And it also helps, you know, engagement leads to retention. And there's not a university employee in the world right now that's not concerned about retention and enrollment. So I think that engagement really is the key to all of that.
Well, engagement is the word that you said there is key, but I also heard a couple of other words that I wouldn't necessarily always expect. One of them was loud. So tell me how loudness works into your strategy.
Well, I have to back up a little to explain the loudness and explain that a few years ago, I flipped my classroom. So what that means is that I put my lectures on YouTube, my quote unquote lectures, right? The highlights from a particular book chapter, et cetera, what I want them to know. I put those on YouTube. That freed up class time for more activities and more discussion because I didn't want to be the one talking all the time, right? And it's a media class, so I'm learning as much from them, hopefully, as they're learning from me. So once I flipped the classroom, which incidentally was exceptionally helpful to my students whose first language was not English, because they could watch the videos more than once, they could pause the videos, and many of the videos on YouTube are closed captioned. Okay, so there were lots of benefits to putting the lectures on YouTube on that platform. So now that I had more time in the classroom, well, then I went one step further and I gamified the class. And essentially what that means is that I put them in teams and every class period, we had some sort of team competition related to that day's course content. And we had traveling trophies. There was smack talking. There were secret handshakes. There were Discord pages just for certain teams. There was a lot of competition. And what was so great is that it was fun and it was loud. And I teach in a great room in the Spurdip building where each team had its own television with internet access so that they could create something, for example, on their individual screen. And then I could shoot that up to the main screen. And it was so much more active rather than just students sitting there listening to me talk. So we get loud, we do.
I want to talk a little bit about gamification because you mentioned that, but you also mentioned Discord pages. And I think to the casual listener who's not in education might not understand what you're talking about there in a Discord page. Can you explain that, please?
Yes, Discord is actually an app and a website that was originally created for gamers to talk to each other. Well, last year when the pandemic happened, we were halfway through the semester and my class created their own Discord page for us. Because as wonderful as Canvas is for course content, there's not really a good place on Canvas to have that immediate conversation, that quick check-in with someone. And there was a lot of that that needed to happen last semester because we felt so disconnected from each other suddenly. And so the Discord page is somewhere, the students all have the Discord app on their phones and they check it frequently. So there was a Discord page for each one of my classes, and we had separate sections of that page for, there was a section for memes, there was a section for pandemic coping skills, there was a section for advice, then there was a section for course content. So we used Canvas, but we also used Discord as a supplement. And it's just an additional way to create connections with students. And I didn't make it mandatory at all. It's Discord is strictly voluntary, but I found that most students are on it and are hungry for that connection, especially now since we're not necessarily on campus as much as we want to be.
So that evolved in its own way, which is great to have that naturally happen in a classroom. I do want to get back to gamification, but you talked directly about teaching in a pandemic. So does the book have a chapter or two or more about the circumstance that we're all teaching and living through right now?
Well, actually, as most listeners probably know, the book was finished before the pandemic actually hit in March. So although there is not necessarily a chapter about how to teach during a pandemic, there is information in the book that works for engagement tools, both in person and in the Zoom or Canvas environment. So a lot of the tools that I reference in the book would be appropriate for an online course as well as an in-person course.
So when we're talking about the online environment, we at Webster tend to use Canvas, but there are other platforms like Blackboard, others that educators engage with. I guess the other question I have about where the book is pitched is, you obviously are teaching in the university setting. Can K through 12 teachers pick up some great ideas in this book?
Actually, K through 12 teachers are light years ahead of us in pedagogy because they have all had education classes. They have certification. Many of us, you know, might be experts in our field, but it doesn't mean we necessarily know how to teach it, right? So the target market for the book is not just college instructors, but specifically adjunct instructors, which I think is really interesting because in this environment, adjuncts have the most to lose, right? Because if enrollment drops, there are fewer sections to go around. And so in many cases, the classroom retention and the course evaluations play a role in which adjuncts get which sections. And so I think that that would be helpful for engagement and retention also.
So help us with the gamification piece now. I promised that we would get into this a little bit. Gamification, you set up these contests in the classroom. Is there any competition for grades, or is it just you get to be the classroom winner during that particular period?
There's a lot of different ways that people set up gamification. Some teachers, and again, I'm stealing all these ideas from K-12 people. Some teachers use badges, you know, like similar to a video game. I chose the team aspect. Last year, it was a Star Wars theme. So we had Team Luke, Team Leia, Team Vader, Team Chewie, and Team Han. And the traveling trophy was a Yoda, okay? And it was something everybody got into because we're all familiar with it. And it was very important that they understood that their individual grades still relied on their quizzes and their exams. The team stuff was just for fun. Now I'm using air quotes talking about fun. They didn't realize how much they were learning while we were doing all this. In their minds, they're just trying to beat Team Luke, right? But they're working together, they're collaborating, they're solving puzzles together, they're communicating, and they are retaining the information in a different way than if they're cramming the night before an exam. So the grades, the gamification did not affect the grades at all. Although, Rick, this was interesting. I compared the overall test grades to a semester of the exact same course with the exact same exams that I did not gamify. And the gamification semester, the average was 10 points higher. And I stopped taking attendance because they all came. They didn't come for me. They came because they didn't want to let their team down. It was really interesting. One team even had a theme song that they played when they walked in together. It was fascinating to me And I even had one student say, I wish this was a Monday, Wednesday, Friday class instead of just Monday. Like, who says that, right? But I had, it was a Trojan horse, because what I was selling them was really in-depth learning of the topic, but they were just having fun. They didn't see it. And the proof was in the exam scores. So that's something that I really miss in this socially distanced environment, because we can't have that room full of loud students. We're all 12 students at a time, 6 feet apart. It's a different chemistry.
I think I read somewhere on a social media feed or online that the greatest compliment that you had ever received from a student was that they never thought about playing a game, an online game, in your classroom.
Yeah, that is high praise, isn't it?
That is a high compliment.
Yeah. And you know what? Something similar happened last semester, because I assigned a reading from this book called Everything Bad is Good for You by Stephen Johnson. It's just a really interesting take on video games and television. And a student said, man, Ms. Smith, I didn't check my phone once when I was reading this. And I thought, okay, I can die and go to heaven now, because I will never get a better compliment from a student than that. I didn't check my phone once. And how many meetings can we as adults say that we have not checked our phones, right? I think we are just as guilty of doing that as adults.
So thank you so much, Julie Smith, our guest today on the Webster World Report. She joined us via Zoom from St. Louis County, Missouri. Her new book is Wake Them Up, Supercharge Your Classroom Engagement. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks so much for having me.
Coming up, from classroom engagement to online education in a pandemic. More from the Webster World Report in a moment.
Assalamu alaikum. Hello from Webster University in Tashkent. Our campus is the first and premier American university in Uzbekistan. Established in 2019, we offer an ever-expanding list of undergraduate majors and graduate programs. As of fall 2020, the Tashkent campus has more than 1,000 enrolled students. In this dynamic higher education market, we are constantly on the lookout for new faculty and staff. If you are ready to embark on an adventure in a safe, affordable, modern country with a rich history and exciting future, reach out with an email. We will be happy to hear your ideas about how you can get involved at Webster University in Tashkent. Contact us at this email address, uzcareers@webster.edu. That's spelled uzcareers@webster.edu. We look forward to hearing from you. Khair, have a good day.
Welcome back to the Webster World Report. Earlier this year, we started a discussion with Michelle Loyet, Associate Vice President of Online Education at Webster and the Director of the University's Online Learning Center. We talked to her about the challenges of online education during a pandemic and how she approaches the needs of students in the online environment. Here's the second part of our discussion, held via Cisco WebEx from Ferguson, Missouri.
Now, since we have entered this period of alternate operations, shall we say, during the COVID-19 pandemic, we have sort of turned our operations into not only working with those students who were fully online and who, you know, may never attend a course at a campus, but also helping students who may be moving into the fully online environment during this time, and also supporting our classes that are being offered via real time, and in some cases even via WebEx, like we're talking today, in supporting those classes as they're being offered while we are not able to access our campuses. So our focus has broadened significantly. And one of the things that I think has really helped us is that we have played for the last few years. We've played a significant role in supporting what we call our WebNet Plus delivery model, which is initially focused on linking classes at extended campuses that in some cases, the reason was to prevent cancellation, that they were maybe 2 to 3 campuses that might have been at risk for a cancellation of a class. But if we combine them, then the students can still move forward in their programs and still actually come to campus and participate in those classes. And that's really where the WebNet Plus modality originated, was that linking of classes at extended campuses. Very quickly after that, we started seeing students that wanted to attend from home. That if I'm going to join electronically, can I avoid, you know, the coming to campus? And I'll just attend in the same way during real time and participate in real time from home. And then we started to move into the area of actually offering programs in that way. For example, the MPA, a Master's of Public Administration, is offered out of Little Rock to online students who can join the classes that are actually taking place at the Little Rock Air Force Base and Little Rock Metro. And then also legal studies here in St. Louis is also offered mainly from the downtown campus, and students are able to join as online students from anywhere, but they're joining those classes that were taking place in real time. So because we had already played a role there.
That would be the Gateway campus in downtown St. Louis, yes?
Yes, the Gateway campus in downtown. But because we had been playing this role in the WebNet Plus delivery, when it became clear that we were going to have to close campus for a period of time due to CV-19, it was not perhaps as hair-raising an idea to move an entire university online as it could have been, because we had already been working in this WebNet Plus modality. So in many cases, it was a matter of helping people to move into a modality that already existed at the institution. We didn't have to invent a whole new way of delivering classes.
What else would you like to discuss?
You know, that one of the things that we're really seeing as a part of this change to an entire university being online for a period of time is that one of the things that we really have to be aware of in online delivery is that we have to be aware of social equity issues. That we have a number of students that are very challenged in their continuing their education because of a lack of equipment, a lack of internet, you know, and really the challenges that people are facing in terms of even just housing, to be able to find a quiet space to be able to do their work from home. So many of our students are facing significant difficulties that stem from that issue. And as an institution, and as a professor, and as a support staff at the institution, we have to be aware that access can be a significant issue for our students in ways that perhaps we had not anticipated as we move to this environment.
Most of our online students are adult learners, but I wonder what you can say to the incoming freshman student who might want to take an online class and just live through a semester of moving their face-to-face classes in emergency settings into the online space. What can you communicate to that person about what Webster is offering?
I hope that everyone is aware that every single office of the university is working to create an experience for our students who are coming in as freshmen, that while it might not be the same experience that students had last year, it is still going to be intellectually engaging, and it is still going to help them create community among their peers, and it is still going to move them forward in their education. I know that there has been a fear of kind of like a lost year for a lot of students, and while it might not be the year you expected, it is not a loss. That we still have the ability to provide a sound educational experience. And Webster, as an institution who's been delivering online education since 1999, and we've been delivering WebNet Plus for a number of years as well, that we're really uniquely situated to be able to do this and do this well, because we are experts at it. So being able to expand what we know about online education and what we know about synchronous online delivery, and being able to expand that into things like orientations and learning communities and freshman seminar, and I'll get dinged because that's not the name anymore, but because we have that experience, we are uniquely situated to bring these students in and help them transition into the university as a freshman, even though it might not have been the freshman year they expected. One of the challenges that we are going to face is in understanding the students that are coming up. I had a very, very traditional undergraduate and graduate experience. I attended Washington University. It was very traditional, very much the sage on the stage. Didn't talk about flipped classroom because you paid that money to get the expert, right? That was, again, a very traditional experience. I left home to, go to where I was supported in my research as a graduate student. I was a TA. Now, the majority of the students that we're working with now, that kind of approach, even the personal approach on the part of the student, is very much in the minority. Even our adult graduate students are digital natives and are not going to necessarily want to approach education in that very traditional way. For those of us that maybe are a little bit out of touch with the drivers of our students today, and maybe didn't grow up as digital natives, really have to make an effort to understand what these students want and what they are asking of us. And really what they are asking of us is not the traditional education that those of us experienced. And we have to be able to broaden our views.
Thank you so much. Our guest today on the Webster World Report, Michelle Loyet, the Associate Vice President for Online Education at Webster University, joining us via Cisco WebEx from Ferguson, Missouri. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate the opportunity to talk with you.
Thanks for listening to our program. The Webster World Report will return with a new edition on Friday, November 20th, 2020. We'd like to add your voices to our podcast. If you're a student, a staff member, or a member of the faculty, reach out to us. Send us a short audio clip from your cell phone or contact us via email to volunteer to be interviewed on the program. You can find us at covid19@webster.edu. You can also send questions or comments to that email address about our world in crisis. That address again is covid19@webster.edu. Also, check out the university's COVID-19 resources pages at webster.edu/COVID-19. The Webster World Report is now available on iTunes, Spotify, Pandora, Google Podcasts, Amazon Music, and of course, SoundCloud. You can also hear the program on your Alexa speaker via TuneIn. Also, our report is featured on KWRH-FM Radio 63119. That's 92.9 FM in Webster Groves, Missouri. Thanks for joining us this week. The Webster World Report is produced by students, staff, and faculty at Webster University. For announcer Jennifer Starkey, news reporter Tierra Gray, and associate producer Jennifer Gamich, I'm Rick Rockwell. Stay healthy and safe.
The Webster World Report is produced by the Global Marketing and Communications Division of Webster University and through the facilities and copyright support of Webster School of Communications. This program is copyright 2020.